coming. This is the September annual, the September regular meeting of the Rochester-Stockbridge Unified District Board. The first item is adjustments to the agenda. I would like us to add communication and outreach as a discussion item, please. And I don't know if you guys had any things you needed to be added?
I have FY18 financial update.
Okay, we will also add that under reports, we'll add a central office, under six, we'll add a central office report, FY18 update.
Is it possible to bump one planet up?
It is absolutely possible, but no, I want you to sit here for the longest time. Yeah, no, no, absolutely. We can certainly bump one planet up. Let's do that now.
Really?
Absolutely.
That's quick. I know that you had...
Actually, I'm sorry, one thing I realized. Ma'am, are you here to make a public comment, or?
No, I'm here to solicit.
Okay, okay. I would extend you the same courtesy to get whatever you need to get off your chest ahead of one final report, but since she's just listening, go ahead.
Okay. There was some questions about, a letter went home with families this fall regarding some cuts that were made to the One Planet grant. We received the 21st Century grant. And that resulted in some cuts to our programming. And I think, Jenny, you were just looking for more information. So you're not...
Update, see where the...
So the cut is due to, we have eight schools covered by that grant, but we have three different grant cycles because we applied for, like, South Royalton, Cambridge, Sharon, our one group, Chelsea and Newton, our one group, and the old Windsor Northwest schools, our one group. Chelsea and Newton are the most recent grantees. They get, in years one, two, and three, they get 100% of funding from that grant, and then year four, they're dropped down to 85%, year five, 75%. So we're in year four. That drop from 100% to 85% amounted to $40,000. So, and what we've done is we've loaded our expenses onto Chelsea and Newton the past few years because of COVID. And so some of those shared expenses we've put into Chelsea and Newton because the state would pay for them. But so now that we've lost that $40,000, you know, it impacts all the programs. We have to write the grant this year. We're, even though we're only in year four for Chelsea and Newton, we're in year five for the other sites. So we'll reapply for all of the sites again. When we do that, we can increase the amount. So what I've done is over the years, all of the other sites, the non-Chelsea and Newton sites, we could only ask for up to 50%. Over time, what the state wants to see is continued sustainability. So I've kind of lowered that. So now we're only at about 40% for those older sites. What I didn't know and was not explained to me, and I did get an apology from the state from this, is that I thought when we lost the $40,000, we could up our 40% of the other sites and it would even out. They wouldn't let me adjust the asking amount for the older sites. So this year when I write the grant, I will write it so that we are funded at 50% across the board. So we're all kind of even there. And when I write the grant, you know, one thing to think of as a board, and I'll be addressing that with administrators, is just, do we want to continue with a proposal that would continue our current programming? Is this meeting the need of our community and our kids? I think it will probably look very similar. Maybe there are some things, and I have some ideas of how we might address our highest need kids a little bit better. But that is something to think of. This is the year I'm writing the grant. I don't want to do it for another something that we want to. One thought I did have for Stockbridge Rochester is maybe expanding to a 5-week summer. I think that probably, we have 6 weeks happening at some sites, 5 weeks happening at some sites, and Stockbridge Rochester is the smallest or shortest summer yet. So I think I will increase the budget to account for that.
Oh, we have a good population for attending those camps.
What's that?
Well, there's a good population attending those camps.
Yeah, we do have a really nice attendance level for summer camp, you know, 30 to 35 kids a day, which is good considering it's, you know, transporting kids from other schools. So anyway, so that was the reason for the drop. The cuts result in, we cut 3 days, so we had a gap program that starts the school year where enrichment teachers aren't coming in. It's more childcare, kids getting used to the school year, whatever. We adjusted the start time until today, the day after Labor Day, so that cut 3 days from our schedule. And then we will likely, I'll look at the numbers again, likely cut 2 days at the end of the school year. We felt like those days had the least impact on our kids. They do affect our working families, but they are essentially childcare days. And we haven't always offered those days. We expanded into those days over time. And we have to be careful of our expenditures. We just keep spending more and more, and I've been able to keep up with it, but they do at the state look at your per pupil spending, regardless of how much grant funding. They look at your per pupil spending. So if I go get a different grant, we still have to, and I spend all that money, we still are looking at that full amount. So so I think we do have to be careful. And then the other cut we made was those like partial weeks, Thanksgiving, where you have a couple days. There's a week before Christmas, so we will do programming that week, but it won't be, it'll be in-house, it'll be our core staff doing programming. But like the week of Thanksgiving, the week you get back from winter break, there are about 4 or 5 days where we are not having enrichment teachers come in. And that, I think, is going to work out fine because it has always been kind of a, that way we're going to have 3 10-week sessions. So there's going to be pretty much 10 Mondays, 10 Tuesdays, 10. It always in the past we've had like 11 or 12 or 9 or whatever, and it kind of evens it out. But I don't think it's going to impact the kids. I think sometimes when you have in between sessions a little break from enrichment, they like that. They can have, you know, just free choice time.
So there's still the child care.
Yeah, the program will be running, but it's kind of like you'll have a couple of gap days in between the
stuff. Doing that at all sites, is that been able to,
yeah,
to help you stay within your...
Yeah. So those were the only cuts. We don't foresee more of those cuts. We'll have to, when we write the grant, decide whether we want to add that back in, or if we look at using that money to expand our summer program or something like that.
I think it'd be nice to, when are you intending to write the grant? When's the grant deadline?
I think it's due in February, mid-February.
So we have some time. It'd be nice to, if we could, try to at least see if you put it in the school newsletter, see if there's any interest in parents coming in and having a conversation. So we can,
yeah,
we can get there, but I personally, I think, you know, as someone who, especially when my kids were going through Stockbridge, we had half day kindergarten, so always child coverage, even with my wife working out of the house, was always tricky. I think it's a wise idea to say maybe ramp back some of the enrichment activities to maintain the coverage. Again, I think adding more coverage in the summer, you know, would be a good thing to do, rather than perhaps increasing some of the increasing enrichment. Because I think one of the realities is, especially, you know, in a choice town, is that, well, that's one of the things families look at, is if I move into here, is it going to help me with my child care situation? You know, I think that's thought about as much as how much enrichment will my kids get. So, you know, I think it'd be great, and thank you for bringing to us this to us at a time so we have a chance to consider, you know, some way to do some community outreach and get their opinions. But I think, again, you know, we'll get to it when we talk about communication later. I think the earlier and the more often we're reaching out to our families and our communities, the more they're feeling engaged and involved in the decision, and the more they're feeling like we're not just doing things, you know, kind of on our own timetable and by our own whims, and just telling them sort of after the fact what's happening. So I think, I think that outreach would be good for that. Would that be something that you would want to participate in or help with, or should we just organize some conversations and get back to you? Or?
Well, one thing they could do is I am going to reach out to the administrators and ask that a committee be formed to help support the grant writing process. I mean, it is like a full, it's due in February. I start tomorrow.
Yeah.
It's a big process, and it does determine what you're doing for the next 5 years, in the summer and after school. So
maybe if you could give, you know, all the administrators some talking points, and they can facilitate that, that would save you going to eight different facilities and having, but you could set the administrators up to facilitate that conversation. Probably by the time we can get a community conversation set up, they'd be prepared to all be asking the same questions, and so that we're getting consistent information to make not only the best program for us, but the program that jives the best with the rest. But I see your point about if we're all in the same cycle, if we're all doing the same programming, if we're sharing the same enrichment resources, there's probably some economies of scale and that we can be taking advantage of. Any other questions? What? Oh, no worries.
It was with
a
student issue.
We added community outreach and Ginger's FY18 report to the agenda, and we moved one planet report up so that someone else can enjoy the rest of the evening.
Can I make a public comment?
Sure.
Okay, sorry. I'm glad you had it. I'm wondering, this might be more of a continued conversation with Bonnie, but I don't know if it's I don't know. So, pre-K. I think the expanded pre-K has been wonderful for our community. We have a lot of kids that are coming to kindergarten and aren't ready, and we can need those extra hours. I guess I'm not in a unique place because I have the three or four other parents that I've talked to at preschool who I do know have said similar things as my responses. I'm really glad we have the longer hours, but I wish we didn't have to do 5 days. And I think, I'm wondering now, I understand that we got the news about the grant late in the game, you gotta get the program, you gotta just make decisions and put it out to families, and I totally understand the need to have them commit to pre-K. We've never had that before. You just pick and choose your days. And, so I think now that we're at that point, I'm wondering if we can be a little creative and or flexible about, you know, maybe allowing families, I'm not talking about anything significant, but maybe saying you have to commit to 4 days, and figuring out a schedule that, or that maybe that's too complicated, maybe just say Friday's an optional day. I guess I'm wondering what the loss would be in that. I mean, I think that potentially you might have families who really, where their child is in a situation where more is better, might then not opt to come on Fridays. So that would be the potential pitfall. But for those families who are feeling a little bit like me, I mean, I'm losing a lot of money this year because I'm not losing it. I've never made it. But I purposely capped my hours to 32 hours a week. You know, so that 20%, I've not making that, you know, other 20% of so that I can be home with my daughter. And then, you know, now, and that's Phyllis on Fridays. Now she has to go to preschool until 1:15. And I just wonder if there could be some flexibility. I don't expect us to go back to that wishy-washy, like, pick your days. But maybe if you said something like, you have to commit to 4 days, or you make Friday an optional day, or maybe even look at, like we do during the school day, our regular, you know, school, look at what the need is. You know, I'm sure that Lauren does, I don't know, you know, what you do in Stockbridge, but I think all of the pre-K teachers do some sort of assessment. So could the pre-K teacher assess the students and make a recommendation and say, you know, your child is not at target. We're going to recommend that you do this at day, or something like that.
You don't want to do that. You can't. And then you know that Friday is for specifically for kids who have a problem. You really can't do that.
Well, I don't think that would mean...
I understand where you're coming from, but I think we really discuss it. The research is really clear that these kids, especially those that you're talking about, need 5 days, and while you'll do a lot with your daughter, other parents won't. They won't be able to. They don't have the resources. And really, for the teacher, having been a pre-K teacher, it's a really bad situation when you don't have those kids there and you want to go on teaching and some are there and some are not there.
I think there need to be a system, certainly, so you know who to expect, but, and I wouldn't want it Fridays to be just for the kids that are below target, but rather there'd be a recommendation. For instance, we have teachers who recommend kids for the academic tutoring in the summer. So we only, you know, communicate to the parents that the tutoring is for the kid that needs it. We have counselors that recommend, you know, regular summer camp for kids that need the extra socialization. So we recommend to those parents that they do the summer camp. But of course, we've got all other kind of kids, you know, attending as well. I just think, you know, I don't want to misuse your words because you actually were talking about something totally different, but they stuck with me. I don't think we want to put systems in place that forces families apart, basically. I don't think that, you know, I know there are a lot of families that need that 5 day, but I also think we should value, you know, those families that want to spend extra time with their kids and have that.
I'm still in agreement with this, Carrie. I haven't changed my point since last meeting. I really don't think that should be required for 5 days. I think there should be some flexibility. I understand that it's good for, you know, children, but I just feel like they're in the system for so long. I just really think that there should be a little bit of flexibility and the preschool for not having to be 5 days a week. It's just kids start kindergarten, it's full time, it's 5 days a week for the next 13 years.
I'll tell you, I wouldn't recommend it at all, and I certainly wouldn't want it for Stockbridge. We have already had 5 days a week. It would then mean that there would be an unequal program. This would be open for all kids at Stockbridge. It would not be open to all kids at Rochester, and I don't think that's a good idea. I looked briefly at the principal's report. There's a waiting list. There's 12 4-year-olds and there's a waiting list for 3-year-olds, so it doesn't seem as though parents are having difficulty doing that.
I don't think
that. But I think we should give it a chance. I mean, you're not even...
Oh, I love it. I love it. It's not that I don't love it. In fact, you know, I can fill that Friday until 1:15 really easily. I think where I'm coming from is just, is it better for her to be in preschool or be with me? I'm coming
that's
up with me, you know?
But that's your, you might decide, no, I want to keep her 5 days a week. But
yeah.
That's your decision. But
I
that has to be something
five,
that
yeah.
is out there that is best for the whole community. And based on research,
I know, but this is like a one, I think what we've come up with is basically, a one-size-fit-all sort of scenario. And I think in talking to the parents who I don't know all of them, but I can think of 3 parents who said the exact same thing I said, which was, I love that the hours are longer, but I wish we didn't have to be 5 days.
Well,
they're committing to it, so maybe that's all you need to know, and that's all you care about. I just felt like I should express that because...
Well, I mean, it's a new program, and you know, like anything you're doing new, I think it's important to, you know, run it for a while, stop and take a look at it. I mean, you know, one of the, you know, put it on the table, one of the things you could do is your kid could be sick every Friday, you know. It's certainly out there as an option, and you know, could there, you know, could there be flexibility in the conversation? I don't know. I think we have to. I think it's worth looking at it because,
yeah.
You know, again, there's a difference between I think a parent that wants to do, you know, personal enrichment with their child, whether it's, you know, we've had parents talk with, you know, take their kids skiing to ski patrol, and they can get them to. So certain days. One of the things I worry about though is the whole, would it be unbalanced? I mean, it would seem to me that if a couple kids were pulled out every day, you'd still have this, you'd have more of a commonality of dynamic than you would if everyone had optional Fridays and there were just the four kids left there at Fridays where the teacher's like, I really can't advance anything I'm studying because 60% of the kids aren't here.
Yeah.
So, but certainly, you know, I think it's, you know, I would ask you, let's stick with it for, you know,
yeah,
for a period of weeks just to see how it runs out. But I think it's certainly something to be worth considering, whether it's, you know, whether it's a fixed policy up to 5 to 4, whether it's you can come and have a conversation, you know, with them, and if, you know, you say, I would like to take my kid out for a day, and they say, well, your kid's on or above target, versus you can always have a day off if you want or whatever.
Right.
I think,
yeah.
Talking about that, I don't even know what we can do in terms of, you know, having differentiated attendance rules anyway. But certainly,
like,
we can look at
a waiver system, you know, where a family applied specifically and said, and asked for a waiver for, I think you should always have a commitment of a certain amount, because no matter what kid it is, they're not going to get anything from preschool if they're coming one day a week. So
well, I think you really have to be here at least,
yeah,
you know,
I mean,
at least 80% of the time.
I think 40,
maybe one day a week, one day every other week.
Yeah.
You know, you get into something that,
yeah,
that gets closer. But I certainly understand the logic. But I certainly think we, you know, we'll look at that for you.
I think the other thing is probably came as a quick shock. It's a very quick change, and so nobody's had time to really prepare for it, and to know, okay, when my child becomes, or they're going to go full time.
Yeah.
You know, so they just didn't have that option. They didn't realize that was where the problem was.
Yeah, and I don't mean to sound negative. I think it is a huge improvement from where we were last year. Even though last year's schedule might have been, I won't even say it was better for my family because the 11:30, the 2.5 hour thing was just crazy short. But there was a lot more flexibility. But I think for our community, we're in a much better place. I worry about those families that are like mine, you know, that would like to have a little flexibility.
I think to your point, Carrie, as well as Amy's, is it was a sort of a late summer decision, so there wasn't a lot of lead up time.
Yeah.
And you know, I'll be very honest, I've sent a strong message that the 4-year-old program is this and the 3-year-old program is this.
Yeah.
But because of the shortness of time to prepare for it, to Amy's point, we haven't actually said to anybody, you can't come if you're not going to show up on Friday or you're not going to show up on Wednesday. So,
yeah.
I do understand that we have to sort of walk through this first year kind of carefully. It's probably, it's certainly a reason the board has to consider. It's by no means the most important reason. One of the reasons for the 5 days is to get the 25 hours in, which is part of the grant if you're going to get subsidies for your expanded program. There's a 25-hour minimum.
Okay.
And there's no way to get 25 hours in 4 days. So if a lot of folks opt, I mean, there's a lot of other reasons why I don't necessarily think we should run it as a 4-day program for 4-year-olds, but if a lot of folks opted out, the board would be in a situation where they'd have to provide more money to operate the programs, because we would, like, you're losing money in your grant, we lose money in the pre-K.
Yeah.
So it's that 25 hours a week to be a subsidized preschool.
In order to get the subsidies.
But I do understand, and I've welcomed any parent that wants to come and chat with me to come and chat. The only thing I would say that I'm committed to holding this notion, and I'm glad you recognized it so much better than last year, because to have a different group of kids every day is almost impossible for Lauren to teach, because you've got, you know, these 13 this day, and you've got a different 13 the next day, and you've got yet a different 13 on the Friday, so that's really, that's difficult for her. But I will say on a positive point, well, I'm going to talk about that later, but Lauren made the comment today that the expanded hours, not only does she feel less stressed than lunch, but she can see it in youngsters.
Yeah.
There's now time to really play.
The expanded day, as so, far as like from 2.5 hours to 5, I think is great.
And I sat in on a 4-year-old lunch the other day, and if anybody wants to have a treat, come and have lunch with 11 4-year-olds in Lauren. Yeah. It's just magic. It really is just magic.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great night, Jeff.
Yeah, me too. Oh, gosh.
All right. In the thick packet that Bruce passed around as the consent agenda, we have minutes from Thursday, June 5th. Which at least my scanning over looks fine. I would entertain a motion to approve minutes.
Make a motion to approve. I second that.
You make the motion.
I make the motion to approve the minutes.
Do I hear a second?
Do you second?
Any discussion of the minutes? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The minutes of June 5th are approved. We have the minutes of Tuesday, August 7th in front of them. I would entertain a motion to approve the minutes as presented.
Make a motion.
Second. Wait here a second.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The minutes of August 7th are approved. Let's go ahead and do you want to do the principal's report first or discussion items? Anyone care? Or actually, why don't we do Ginger and then she can go too.
Side, which we so quickly with a family just moving out of work.
Right.
And also we probably had some tuition revenue projected from high school kids, and we closed our, we took the kids out.
Yes.
We just get the end out.
Absolutely.
And then the third page are food service financials, which is probably more detailed than you guys have ever seen, but I've been elbow deep in food service for a long time, so this is what I'm used to providing from Donna. So Rochester's food service program looks really good this year.
Yay!
So, there's a profit of over $27,000, but you also have to factor in that there's a $75,000
subsidy. $75,000 subsidy.
But we did subsidize it. Okay.
Right. Yes.
So our goal
but it is to
continue
better.
To get
it's getting better.
I know. It's
yeah. Our goal is to continue to reduce the subsidy, and you know, I can't make any promises, but we see some places where we can start making some inroads fairly soon. I don't know that it'll make up the whole $70,000 in a year.
No,
our hope is to make
this
up.
Is the road that we've been going down for a while.
Right.
Rochester has always had a food service. A large subsidy, and it was always an issue. So we've been working for the past couple of years to get this better.
It
seems like we are.
Are there any questions on Rochester before I move on to Stockbridge?
Yeah, just give me a second to look over it.
Okay, no problem.
Pretty much.
What we got in this on this FY 17-18 is what we're going to carry, is the amount we're going to continue to get.
Slightly lower. Honestly, I'm not completely familiar with the small schools grant. I'd like to look into that.
Part of the merger guarantee was that we would
It's a difference of $1,600. It's not huge, but it, just to have an understanding for as we're going forward, what the numbers are going to be looking at.
Now, I thought one thing that concerns me on the Rochester side of the revenue page, the transportation grant was really kind of underestimated, it seems.
Oh, yeah. This is
I did catch that, and I really hope that the auditors have some insight on what went
wrong. Right, because that, as I understood it, that formula was really pretty fixed, and that wasn't something that should have varied that much.
So, I'm sorry, what are you looking at? The state aid?
State
yeah.
So if you could just explain what that is to me,
that's the money that the state
gives you a certain amount of your transportation costs. Right. And usually, like if you look at the Stockbridge side, it's like off by $12 or something like that.
Okay.
And that's usually the variance I'm used to seeing, is that, you know, $65.
Okay, so
we spent $65 more from the state than we thought. I've never really seen.
And they do this by miles, driven?
They do it by expenses over the last, you know, there's a formula that I thought was pretty fixed. I didn't want to think of the Rochester transportation change, and I wouldn't have thought it would have grown. I wouldn't have thought it would drop.
We can certainly check into that number to make sure.
And one of the things, probably, you have that is when this, I believe, when this original budget of $30,000 was set, the Rochester Middle and High School program was still in operation.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. And that summer, they closed and offered choice, so we were transporting a lot more kids over a lot more miles. That could account.
We didn't provide transportation for our choice kids. To get to another high school.
You can only bring kids. It's illegal. If you provide transportation for any choice child to a school of their choice, you have to provide transportation for every choice child to the schools of their choice. So the way it always works is receiving schools will try to bring a bus near, like that's why Ripton was sending me down for a while or whatever, Middlebury. And like Woodstock always talked about getting closer to us, but never did. So all our kids
7 a.m. pickup in Pittsfield or 7:15 in Barnard. But it's dependent on the receiving school sending transportation. Because they can just receive, they can run bus routes to bring kids to their schools wherever they want.
But it's a set formula of miles and expenses and
yeah.
That gets reimbursed to us.
Yes.
Right.
Okay. I think it would be something to
make sure that's a real number.
Which is fine. We want revenue. I don't want it to go away.
Yeah, well, that's unfair because we're already 60 grand in the hole. I mean, it looks like we're 60 grand in the hole in Stockbridge, in Rochester, and only 3,500 up in Stockbridge.
Wait,
Stockbridge.
No, not 60 in the hole. I thought we were...
We have a $58,000 surplus in expenses, but we have $118,000 deficit in revenues.
So total year,
Rochester side would start with a $60,000 deficit, and Stockbridge is $3,500 in the green or in the black rather. That's not good.
Why are we in the red? We were told we were not ending the year in the red. We were quite on the other side. What changed?
There were special ed costs that weren't billed to you at the end.
Right,
I think it's really preliminary, so we need a little more time, I think.
Draft, let's write a draft all of us.
Yeah.
Okay.
I also think that David didn't realize how many billbacks happened at the end of the year for shared positions, assessment, the special ed assessment. He wasn't really aware of the timeline of those things when he gave you guys preliminary numbers. So that might be where there's a big difference.
And the only thing we can really accurately give you an update on during the school year is the expenditure side. We can tell you what we've spent. What we can never tell you is what the revenues are going to be until it's over and not really until your auditors
come. And even the expenses are moving rapidly, and they move the
very
rapidly at the beginning and end of the school year.
Right, which is why I thought the transportation thing is concerning, because usually clicks in every year about this, you know, we're usually pretty on target with that.
But you did say right off the bat that there is the special ed assessment is likely to change.
Yes.
To lower.
Yes.
Okay. You look directly at the camera when you say $2,000 in E-rate that apparently was not collected, and
And when I look at Rochester, I don't even see a line about E-rate at all.
So E-rate is actually supposed to be an offset to the expense.
Okay.
Okay, great.
So that's how it's properly recorded. So I think that's what happened on Stockbridge side. It was budgeted as a revenue, but recorded in the expense.
Yeah, it's always been a revenue on these two ways we've done here in the past.
And then it didn't show up on the Rochester revenue at all because...
Right. Can we confirm that E-rate was applied for and received? And can we confirm that, you know, get an idea of, you know, we had this amount of eligible E-rate services, and we got, you know, this percentage or this amount of them offset?
Yep. I'm looking
at
my client. What is E-rate?
E-rate is money that the federal government gives you to subsidize or offset specific technology costs. It used to be like telephones and things that moved now to like wireless and internet. But like if we had gotten new antennas in the building, that would be an eligible E-rate expense. It's a tricky program because the federal government decides that they're going to open up this E-rate window and you're supposed to bid things out by a complicated process and blah, blah, blah. And I think we use Marion Kenson, or there's a consultant I think that we use. To calculate that, it's tricky as it is to get the numbers right, but it covers. You have to confirm that you're conforming to the Child and Internet Protection Act. So you have to be able to say you can't look at porn sites or hate sites or drug sites or pro-anorexia sites or whatever on school premises, and then you're educating families about responsible internet use and so on and so forth, which usually means you have an after-school meeting, some or evening meeting or whatever, sometime to talk about that. But it's based on free and reduced lunch percentages, so the eligible expenses, you know, where we are, we probably get about half of them, you know, half of them paid back. And, you know, our connectivity to, I think some of us have, do both of us have EC fiber or only one place?
I think they both do.
Right, so that's gotten a lot cheaper because they were, EC fiber was, is a lot cheaper than, Sobernet or Verizon or Fairpoint or whatever. But, you know, getting 50% of some of our technology costs paid, by just saying we're not going to let our kids go to porn sites, it's a good deal for our taxpayers.
And you have to do that every year?
Yes, you do.
Apply for the E-rate? Mm-hmm. And do we have somebody locally who does it, or is it at the SU level that does it?
It's been done at the SU level, and they contract it out. Right, there's eligible items.
We also have
eligible
improvements that happen absolutely everywhere, every day.
I have the special ed assessment. Special ed in Stockbridge and vocational ed is under regular ed. It's marked differently in Rochester. There's another, special education has its own line, and voc ed has its own. Is there a reason that our special ed is included in our regular ed?
Honestly, this is just a format that Donna used that I plug numbers into because this is okay. So. Really, I was hands off with this year.
I know that David had started bringing for our new budget, broke out all of those SU assessments separately and did just bolt them together. It looks like one of those items got separated on the Rochester one. So you have the same problem with special ed as well.
Yeah, that's a huge.
Oh, at least FDY, all of the districts are the same.
And I'm so sorry, what's the reason again for that? That those expenses came at the last?
Because they didn't build it.
Oh, okay, never mind.
Well, that's the
long
truth.
Okay.
So they just weren't assessed.
Yeah, there was a long period of time, and I had our special ed director figuring that the boards are going to hate me because they're going to see these big bills, but they were bills that were usually assessed more often in little chunks versus one big. We had, this was our to-do list when after July we needed to get those assessments out. Because he was projecting, you know, you were $100,000 to $200,000 in the black, but those bills were not out to you so we were going to see sticker shock when we saw them, which is what I was a little bit about.
Right, and it'd be good to get, I mean, so, the budget shows 135 for Stockbridge, which is 251 the actual expenses, and the budget shows,
128.
I'm sorry, that is Rochester. The budget shows for Stockbridge 128 with 239. So, I mean, having an understanding of, I mean, maybe those numbers will drop, but having an understanding of why we went so over budget in the first place would be good as well, just so that we can be able to say, you know, two families moved in, or there were, you know, we had to do an outplacement of a kid that was here, we had to refer out to somewhere else or whatever, just so that we're building out the story of what happened, you know, now, so that when it's time to talk to the public and when it's time to write the booklet, we can, we have the information about these things, and we don't have to try to scramble around and then make Ginger produce those numbers for us in February, which is already going crazy trying to get everything else done. You know, the more we can front load understanding last year's expenses and last year's revenues and start building that narrative now while she's not as busy with budget season yet, I'm sure it's going to be much easier for her to go through her first budget season at the helm. The population changes so much and the kids' needs changes so much from year to year, she almost just starts out fresh. She almost just looks at, here's the roster of all the kids and all their needs, and here's the staff I need to meet all those needs and mainstream these kids as much as possible, blah, 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 and then build that out, and really doesn't do as much referring back. I think she does look and try to say, well, in general, we've always come in over this much and try to pad it some. But, you know, she doesn't want to overtax us and then give us a lot of money back at the end of the year. And she also, I think, doesn't want to undertax and charge us. So I think she approaches each year almost as a unique individual kind of situation based on the kids, their needs, and the staff she requires.
And then what would be important for Wendy and I is to get the actual auditor's report. And then, so we would want to have that before we started building next year's budget, because that's the foundation we would build next. So once these numbers get moved around and they're on the right place,
right,
that's what lets us know we need this here and that there versus something else. So
right,
that auditor's report is just a very helpful document.
Absolutely.
So the special ed assessment is based on population in need in a school, and there's a formula for it, or, I mean, they're not just taking all the population and dividing it out, because I was questioning that we have such a different population, you guys have 52 and we have 90, but yet our special ed numbers are fairly similar.
Right, now remember, the special ed budget is done at the SU level, so
right,
it is all the SU kids.
It's everything,
and
but...
We just pay a percentage of it that's based on... It's actually based on the average of average daily membership and your child count, I think, for special ed. I can look at the
bottom. But it is interesting to note that, and I'm just looking at, we have less kids, but our...
Yeah, the special ed is not at...
It's not that much less at all.
I totally agree.
Which means that we have a higher percentage of special ed, am I correct?
That's what I was just wondering. That's
can you tell me the percentage of the population that's special ed here, or children who are
in Stockbridge, right?
No, I don't have that off the top of my head. I thought it was like 18% at one point, which is pretty high. And I'd say SU wide. I wouldn't say just here, but
special ed is numbers are high for that many college.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're one of we've historically has actually been one of the higher special needs SUs across the state.
That's really connected, you know, but there's just an important piece to say about that, but I don't know if Bruce is going to talk about it later, but he's directed us to really look at the strategic plan and take very seriously the reading and mathematics part. In the special ed formula in the state of Vermont, after about third grade, if you fall far enough behind, that qualifies you for special education. So everything we can do to keep children at or above standard is going to reduce
that special ed population.
But you have kids that are coming to you in kindergarten that are already 2 and 3 years behind their peers.
Yes.
It's one of the reasons why this was such a good idea to have the early ed work that you're trying to do this year. Not all kids. I mean, I'm not trying to say those kids that are have a lot of parent involvement early probably aren't those kids. But it's important that the teachers don't feel like they're blamed because they're starting out with these kids not knowing letters, not knowing numbers, or their colors, or all that kind of thing. If you look at a page of the strategic plan under Opportunity 2.2.1, if you want to look that up at some point, it was a effort when we put that in there to try to get kids up to grade level by the end of third grade. And I can say more about this later, but that was the whole discussion that we had when we did our retreat with the administrators, and the next discussion happened in front of the entire staff about this. We have found some resources to try to deal with this and put the things in place in order to be able to be successful. Turns out that we have had Medicaid money that we haven't spent for the last 2 years. And we have a significant amount of money that we can devote to this early learning project to the tune of between $500,000 and $600,000. So we've got a meeting scheduled for Thursday morning where we're going to decide. We've hired a data warehouse so that we can dump all our previous scores in it to see exactly where we are by school. We're going to have to decide which things we want to measure. And then going forward, we're going to write a program and try to begin the effort of getting our kids up to grade level in both math and reading by the end of third grade.
So we're going to be investigating and exploring curriculum that's out there, or you want the teachers to write their own?
No, we're going to use research-based things that are already in place. We're not going to use anything that's per chance. And we already have a really good document to start with, and it's called
Delivering
on the Promise. And it's a book that came out in 2004. It's a little old, but basically it's about the Kennewick School District in Washington that it took them 6 years, but they got all their kids 95% on grade level. I don't think it's going to take us 95 or six years to get them there because we don't have the diversity here in Vermont. And we're also not as big a organization as that was. They had like 14 schools or something like that spread out in a huge place in Washington State. But it's been in the strategic plan to do this. We have that plan goes till 2021, and we need to get to it. And it's going to take a couple years for us to realize this, maybe more than a couple. And so I was pleasantly surprised that Medicaid money was there. But what happened was every year Donna used to ask, okay, principals, what do you want to spend that money on? They had to write a plan. Well, none of them, many times they didn't. And therefore, it just rolled over and rolled over. And now we have a pot that's about $65,000 a quarter to the better. So before we start this project, we're going to try to make a plan first and not just ready, fire, aim kind of thing. So
there'll be like a
there'll be a proposal written. My intention, well, we're hoping that we can bring in some retired teachers, really retired at the top of their game, and maybe they would work for us on a part-time basis to try to do this. So we already have one person that we've talked to about this, and that along with, I haven't seen her for a while, but we also have some people that are working with kids now, the integrationist folks. We have a whole team of them. I mean, it's like 15 of them in the SU now. And we're going to try to grab a couple of them to help us write it as well. So I'm excited about it. I couldn't get the principals to stop talking about it. They really want to do this. And I'm hoping that the board will basically reaffirm the goal for us and get on board with us to do this. That money's all your money. It's not SU money, and it's not Rochester money, and it's not royalty money, it's for everybody. And we have to use it for all kids. It can't be just special ed kids or that kind of thing. So this, once those kids can handle the content, when they're, by the end of third grade, they're gonna be better off knowing what they're doing and being able to handle what we give to them. So I think it's a real good thing to do.
And I'm sorry to jump in and clarify. I actually looked at the bylaws. Special education assessment is based on just in proportion of the ADM across the SU. And surprisingly, in 2016, when I look at our merger proposal document, the ADM in Rochester was 98.2, and the ADM in Stockbridge was 88. So those numbers are pretty good. They're closer than they would be just by the actual enrollment, because at that time, we had 13 more kids in 7 through 12 than Rochester did. Because, our quiet majority of middle level school choice came in there. So that's why those numbers are closer. The actual central office assessment is the average of the proportion around enrollment in the school buildings, and then also ADN. So in some ways our assessment will go down. I think SU will go down some in the central office assessment because our enrollment has dropped at Rochester. But our special ed proportions or our special ed numbers will probably stay about the same because our ADM stays close to that. Does anyone else have any more questions for Ginger?
Budget for and how many, what was our projected number that we went with, and where do we wind up with actual enrollment?
those expenditures include everything. So it's salary, it's health insurance, it's not broken out at all. It's math manipulatives, it's... So I can't really answer your question without seeing the...
Okay, I was just
access to that.
Right, I'm not sure. It looks like probably the office of the principal is in there, right? In that regular program.
It looks like it... didn't I see that somewhere else?
You know, the Stockbridge side, you see, it's hard to match these up because, like, Stockbridge has office of the principal about two-thirds down the list, and I don't see...
Oh, school administration is under secretary.
Okay. So I guess I was just saying that it is more than probably just the elementary teachers.
Yeah.
Now...
It's including the supplies for the classroom.
It's all the
costs. It's everything.
Pencils, erasers, paper, copier, all that stuff. Yeah. It looks like it's not broken out anywhere.
So
the copier would probably be in the administration, but...
No, maybe.
But that does bring up a good point. So when we see this information, when it's in the draft from the auditors, will it be apples to apples? Will all my columns heading be the same for both campuses?
I'm not sure what the auditors will provide.
The formatting
is definitely different, and
yeah.
I did not spend a whole lot of time. This is all based on our old software system.
Yeah, no, and that's fine. I get it.
Switch everything around me, so I didn't spend much time on the formatting.
Just as we get closer to budget season and the public starts perking up their ears and starting to want to know what's going on, being able to, you were lucky. You got to miss some of our meetings last year where the Stockbridge people got all about the Rochester things and the Rochester people got all about the Stockbridge things. And so the more that we can have things being an apples to apples, you know, comparison, the easier it's going to be for people to, you like my cat invitation?
I did. So,
I thought it was the easiest way to do it.
But going forward, like, this is the financial statement for the end of FY18, and I'm assuming that we'll get a first quarter statement on, the end of September?
So,
Right,
or October. The obstacle that I'm up against right now is this new software is incredibly time consuming of all of my staff. And we have a new charter pass. So I'm trying to match back the budget that was approved to the accounts that needs to go in before I can get the budget uploaded into the new system. It's hugely time consuming against the time consumption of the new payroll. We just had our first teacher payroll last week, and I wouldn't like to admit it, but it was a slight disaster.
Okay.
Things that we trusted the system on, we learned really quickly that it should not have been trusted.
Okay.
So, that's my goal to have those.
Okay, regardless of when a financial report is going to come to us next, I'm questioning what format it's going to be in. Are we going to be looking up these expenditure accounts and we'll have a Stockbridge and Rochester campus, or are we going to have column lines?
I think the way that I foresee it happening is that they're side by side Rochester, Stockbridge.
All on the same roads. Same roads, okay. And then, of course, with the total, right? So it's going to be a bunch of columns.
It's going to be wide.
Yeah. Rochester Stockbridge, joint, budgeted, actual.
And
okay. I guess I just wanted to confirm that that is what I'm expecting to see.
That,
again, when you are able to.
And this is just so when we go out to our communities,
these
are very active, and they will go over line by line. So we just need to make sure that we're all at the same stuff. And
yes,
it'll make our lives a little bit easier if we can present it in a full manner.
Well, sure, it'll make your life easier if you have the same type of code with an R and then an S, like with the same music line.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. It's a challenge, I'm sure.
Thank you for providing this.
Today we hope to be able to consider any more people.
So are we done with the questions on the financial report? Okay, so Ginger, it's September, which means that we're starting to get tuition bills. I'm not sure, I'm assuming it's the business office. Are you the people who is handling sure that we have residency valid or verifications?
Definitely.
Okay.
So I want to go over what is expected from you guys at the board. This is obviously new for the Rochester folks. What we've done in the past Rochester-Stockbridge is Stockbridge does not require a residency voucher, which we use across the SU, sort of gets the general demographics of the child, where they're going, their age, and all of that stuff, and requires documentation of their residency. Stockbridge has never required that unless it's a student in question, somebody that's moved in, or there's just a little hesitancy of if they're really living there or not. I guess I need to know what the expectations are as a joint board. If it's,
what's the voucher entail?
It's a form that they filled out.
It's very basic. He said that incorrectly. No, we, Stockbridge has, and I David said he didn't see it in the files, but I would put that on failures in past administrations. But Stockbridge has required a form that says, you know, this is my kid, these are my kid's names. You know, it's part of the you know, just the student information gathering where you get the kid's date of birth, their address, and all that. But
is that required annually for all students?
The information form had been required annually, and there needed to be, you know, some proof of residency, like a copy of the tax bill, or like two utility bills. I know that
the form that is used SU-wide, it says if you've been a resident for less than 2 years, please provide, I believe it's 2 proofs of residency, which is something that shows your physical address.
Right. And if it's something that's thrown with someone with a different name, there needs to be a statement of guardianship or of relationship. We've had in Stockbridge, we had kids living with a grandparent, and the grandparent had to show that they were, you know, that they were supposed to be taking care of the kids. And I thought it was 3 years for Stockbridge. If you've been here 3 years, you didn't need to
in all
show
time that
the form
I've been
address the same. But I think, I mean, I don't think it should be loosey-goosey. I think we should, you know, it's not fair to our taxpayers to
we would like you to tell us what you want.
Is the residency form, is the form the rest of the SU's using? And if it's...
You want us to use that?
Yeah, I think it'd be simpler, right? You want to hold you, hold it.
Okay,
right.
So do we restrict payment until we have those forms for all children on the invoice?
I would say yeah, because it's hard to get a meeting. I mean, how hard is back them? I would imagine that's a giant pain.
Back
up? Well, to say we paid you for this kid, and this kid doesn't really have residency here. Give us the money back, would stop. I think it's easier to pay.
The schools that we use, that we associate money with, they're pretty good to deal with in that sense. It does get very tricky when you get, say, an invoice from Woodstock with 10 kids on it, and only 6 of them have the residency voucher, so then you're paying part of it. It's hard on our end to monitor who's been paid for and who hasn't, and it's also hard on their end to monitor who is still outstanding and who the rent is not by name.
I would encourage you around that residency form. It's not hard to fill out, it really is. I would just encourage you to have it before the youngster can start school. That's what's going to get it to you. We spent all of last year trying to get residency from folks in our preschool, and a couple we still didn't have by the end of the year. This year we said if the child's going to start school and need residency, we have it all but one.
Right.
And it just saves hours of tracking people down. And that is a large chunk of money you're paying out for each one of those youngsters.
Right.
The other thing I would encourage you to follow is Ginger's recommendation on is that there's more of this, I have guardianship of this child, that's really informal to get a child to be able to go to school in another town. So guardianship is a legal status. You have to go to court and get guardianship. More and more people are saying, Vine has guardianship of my child. I'm writing you a note that says she's my child's guardian, so she
won't take
school.
That.
You can't, you shouldn't accept. You shouldn't accept.
They need to go to court. They need to get something from a judge that says it's okay.
So a student's residency has nothing to do with where the student resides. It has to do with where the parents reside. So if the student lives with the grandparents,
and they don't have legal guardianship.
The town that they need to go to school in is where the parents live.
Right, unless the grandparents was a legal guardian.
Right.
So, but yeah, I think it's important that we do that and that we're accurate on that, because in Stockbridge we've had cases where someone tries to say, well, here's a property bill for, you know, an acre of undeveloped land that's just kind of somewhere way up, like Lori Hill or somewhere, where it was, you know, a piece of land someone bought for a camp one time and they never used it, and they're trying to say that's residence. I think it's important to
reside
to do that. And it's very tricky, especially, you know, it's parent or guardian, and custody doesn't matter. So we've had, you know, there's been instances where there's a couple that split up. They don't speak to each other. Dad still lives in Stockbridge, but mom's up working in Middlebury, near Middlebury, and we get a bill from Middlebury that says this kid's here, and it can be difficult. We've held up bills, and we've actually had to. It's one of the things I found out is the power of the board. We get the citizen judicial body to hear part of the hearing. We've had to hire private detectives, because if dad's mad at mom and dad doesn't want to deal with it, if dad doesn't sign that form that says, here's my property bill, here's my information about Stockbridge, mom can't write that in for Middlebury and say, oh, this is dad. You know, that bill needs to be provided. And, you know, in the past, we've had issues where, like, we've had to have, you know, Dina's come down and done a hearing for us. We've had to, you know, get a private detective to go drive by an address and say, here's our proof that this isn't a place people live. But we really need to, and David said the same thing, I don't think there's formal rules in Stockbridge. They're always happening. They just haven't necessarily been enforced by the last couple principles.
I think that's reasonable.
And I think at this time, Bruce, I can't think of a good reason for us to have a separate one for you, other than to make you pull out more hair.
We should do the same thing.
My big question is, do we want it for every student, every
I think the same. If the policy in the SU is that if you provide it for 2 years in a row, you know, when you fill out the address and everything else, you say that everything else stays the same. We don't need to get another power bill or whatever. But I think we should follow the same way that you know it's done in Sharon.
I don't think that's the cleanest way to track, because I think we should either require it every year or not require it every year.
So let's
start right now.
Start it every year, and then we'll address that a year from now, because we say that everyone.
Oh, there you go.
Everyone in the new district has to do it. It's a new district.
Right.
So that's what's going on this year, and you know that's what's going, and that just kicked that can down the road for 2 years.
Right, and then in 2 years you can then say that we have an established group of families, kids, and an established list, and let you know.
Right. But we, when I first got here, the woman who worked in the office, and, you know, had kids here, knew everybody, and
right.
She would always say, oh, those families. And, you know, we even had to kind of got a little pushback from her, right. Saying, well, wait, we really need to have the actual.
Oh, I know, George, she's been living over there forever, you know?
So.
Yeah. The biggest culprit is my brother.
All right, so another in case you don't know, this is what Ginger. She knows this. This is her wheelhouse, I think you would say. She does this well.
Okay, great. Well, we will give suggestions.
There we go. So another tuition-related thing that needs to be addressed between the two different towns is payment cycles. In the past, Stockbridge has paid all invoices 100% upfront when the bill is received. Some districts pay it quarterly, some pay it by semester. I do know from you guys what the preference
is. Like, if the income, the school that our kids are going to bills the whole thing up front, Stockbridge would pay it up front, but other schools would stretch it out through the year. Okay. But if the school is billing quarterly, then that's just how it's paid. It's quarterly, like you don't anticipate.
I think there's only one school in that province that bills quarterly. Everybody else bills everything up front.
Is it hard to
pay back? And the SU in general just pays it all up front, or does everyone else pay it?
Stockbridge is the only one that has paid it up front.
Okay, because I mean, again,
we have to pay quarterly. Everybody else pretty much pays by semester.
Is it
would
hard
be
to
easier
get
for you?
I have not had a struggle with anything like that.
I was just thinking, if you pay it up front, the child moves mid-year. Is that a lot of work for you to get it back?
It's not.
Okay.
But honestly, if a child moves mid-year, it's sort of figure that out, unless it's a very small town, it's hearsay.
Right.
And we
think it would,
But if it's a, say,
think of it this way,
Woodstock, their office isn't going to even think, oh, that's Stockbridge's kid. We all have credit. We usually hear about
If they moved Stockbridge to Woodstock half of the year.
Right,
they could still go to the same school, but they can still go to the same school, but we pay their tuition for the entire year.
So
maybe we should try to, would paying that on a semester basis address that? Because Woodstock wouldn't bill us the second semester? Or would I would imagine Woodstock would track that, you know, Johnny moved from...
Woodstock might even not know that they moved to Woodstock.
The family moved to Woodstock?
There's definitely a risk with me.
I mean, does it hurt the cash flow to pay it all up front versus paying it in semesters?
I don't have any complaints from Apple about it. Schumacher's are definitely.
I feel like we should do it in semesters. It just feels like the whole year is too much problem.
Is Stockbridge the only one truly that pays it up front?
Yes.
I mean, one of the advantages of not paying it up front is that if a child does move and we don't know about it, you've got less invested that isn't your responsibility. That's one way to look at it.
So can you change to semester like Carlson did?
Absolutely. I mean, the schools that are sending us a bill, they're still going to send us the entire bill for the entire year. And they're okay if we pay half of it now and half of it in January. They're probably not going to change their original bill unless we say, Johnny's parents moved, so and so off school board, watch them pack their new van.
You want to take a vote on this, or you just show hands, or what do you want to do?
I agree with this. That's the recommendation for this. You said Jerry.
I was very well versed.
Yes.
Okay.
And she took the job.
And I feel that she's very thorough over me. Thank you.
So, yeah, no, I think you just read that. Anything else for Ginger? Okay, Ginger, you can make your escape. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, so let's look at the principal's reports, and then we'll go into the discussion items.
So just kind of going through briefly, it seemed like for the most part, most of you guys know something we don't, that everything went pretty smoothly to start. Everybody seems really happy and excited to be here so far, so good. And there's 53 students here on the Stockbridge campus and 92 over in Rochester, and things are kind of full speed ahead. In Rochester, in terms of the expansion of preschool hours, they have 3 3-year-olds and 12 4-year-olds, and there's 2 3-year-olds on the wait list. There is one youngster who's coming from Rochester to Stockbridge and attending our 4-year-old program. And in Rochester, there's one preschool kiddo who we believe is eligible for special education services, but it hasn't been officially determined yet.
Are you full in Stockbridge now that one child is coming?
No, I have 2 spaces.
Two spots.
Mm-hmm.
So what about the other one that's on the waiting list, the 2 that are on the waiting list, would they come here?
We have suggested that, and they have not taken advantage of that to date.
Here at Stockbridge, we had an open house on Monday the 27th, and Rochester will hold one September 17th from 6 to 7:15. We do have a new full-time music teacher. She actually already has a musical instrument demonstration arranged for both of our campuses, and the goal is to stir up interest for individual lessons. So kids can learn how to take part in that. Our new food service director at Stockbridge is already started training with Lily Walker, and she actually came today to walk through the kitchen and see what we have, what we didn't have, what she's going to need, how she's going to do her own. She plans on being here all day tomorrow to organize and clean. She can't be fingerprinted until next week. So and yogurt and a piece of fruit. It's changed based on the kid. There's some kids that can't have yogurt for whatever reason, so we make do with what we can. But, and then also we kind of put a platter of stuff together for our preschool run in the morning, just because they seem, they're growing quickly. They need a lot of food. And then we still do snack here, which is usually a piece of fruit and some sort of something or other. Jordan was kind enough to order some easy stuff for us to be able to hand out and make sure everybody had.
How are the parents, if, you know, reacting to this lack of, like, I know there's pushback on social media or in general concerns.
That there was other concern, but I think they were really happy.
Right,
excellent. Okay.
I think, so that, once everything was set into place, everybody was fine.
All across Vermont with our lowering unemployment rate. Some schools can't find custodians, they can't find bus drivers, they can't find cafeteria folks, they can't find office folks. So we anticipate, you know, while this employment's low, this may not be the last time we're in a situation. It may not be lunch, maybe something else next time, but these school positions are getting, you know, it's difficult to fill them at this point.
I think the more we can try to find ways of sharing positions to offer more hours, I think that would be a helpful thing for us going forward.
The other thing I'd like to ask before Matt, before Lindy moves on with the board's permission, would be when this is over and done to allow me to write a letter, on, I know on your behalf, to Julie Taylor. She's been coming in early to make ends meet, and when I said, you know, we need to get the hours and get you compensated, and she's like, oh, don't worry about that, I'm not putting those down. So, you know, she doesn't come in a lot early, but she comes in enough early so that it's noticeable because she gets
on the
both programs. So,
she's just very, very careful.
We could just, if I could just shoot off a note on behalf of the board.
That would be great.
Thank you.
Now, does she have somebody else in the kitchen that helps her? She
does. We just barely hired someone. Bruce has allowed her to stay in the kitchen to help us do lunches.
Or she doesn't get near kids.
Because there's this backup on fingerprinting. We're back to the 11th, I think, of September at this point. So.
So the stipulation was, as long as she's away from kids, we can.
Yeah, she's
in the kitchen. Doing dishes.
No, that's basically what we do. She doesn't leave the kitchen.
It's a shame. I mean, I totally understand it. I totally agree. It's just a shame.
Yeah.
And we're still working on hiring a PE teacher for Stockbridge campus. I met with someone on Friday who was interested in taking a long-term sub position, and that looks promising, but he's got to look first to figure out some logistics.
I have another possibility.
Yes.
Fill in your middle of the day. That was provided by Mary Ellen today. Did she talk with you?
We did. And so one of the things that's been a little challenging with this PE position is our special schedule spans out through lunch. So it starts at like 10:20 and it goes to 2:45. So there's this lunchtime in the middle that even though it's half a day, it ends up really being something pretty much full day. So the person that I met with Friday and potentially Simmons has been on the hunt for us to find someone. They both are interested in being able to make sure that it's a morning position. I've been working with teachers on that, their dress schedules, and everybody seems pretty open to the idea as long as we get someone here. So.
The other thing Lindy and I just started talking about this morning, in the event that neither of these candidates come through for whatever reason, we were talking about the notion of having the PE teacher who's at Rochester for 2 days a week, spend 1 day in Stockbridge and 1 day in Rochester. And he's agreeable to that.
He was the one that was here last year.
He was here last year.
Yes.
Yeah, we were just chit-chatting the other day and suddenly this idea came up about, well, why wouldn't we, until we can find somebody, we're right in school, we're just two campuses, why wouldn't we try and split it up this way? So if we can't make anything happen fairly quickly with either of these other two folks, we'll have to pursue that aisle and avenue and see how that works out.
I have to say that I've just really been really happy and appreciative and impressed with the way the two of you have worked together. I mean, whether it's meetings or the way you're presenting or the way you work, I just think it's really, you're really doing a high
membership in the Forest Service.
I learned we're going to have trout in the classroom.
Yes.
Like,
I'm so glad that someone was willing to take that on. I'm next fisheries person.
And we bought wet suits for the preschool, so they get to go out in the rain and the puddles and these little suits that they pull
around.
Little wet suits, right.
Yeah. Which brings us to the pre-K playground.
Yeah.
There's still a mulch pile.
I believe
mountain. Talk about a form of torture during recess for a lot of kids. But it is going to be spread, I believe, to tomorrow night. They didn't come tonight. And in terms of Stockbridge, the fence company that Karen Fleck, who worked with the coordinator at the preschool, they came in with an estimate of $2,500 higher than the quote they gave originally. So our grant coordinator has asked us to get two more quotes.
Yeah.
So we have appointments with Middlebury Company and a local company to come.
So what are you doing with the playground out there? You're putting the mulch down that you have to put in new equipment up to?
Right, we have to put in a specific preschool playground. But that's part of the expansion.
Yes.
And that's going to be in the corner, kind of, right?
Yeah. Like right out there.
Okay.
Can still
and it'll be fenced in.
Right. And then Rochester has been mulched, excavated and mulched.
Yes.
And then the new place structure is here, and they've arrived, and a group of volunteers is assembling it this Saturday. And then the new fence will be installed. And then with both groups, we'll let our 3 and 4 year olds know.
Mm-hmm.
It's not to say they have still have recess. And then during the preview for in-service, we actually got both faculty and staff, both campuses together for lunch, and we worked on drafting some goals for the new school year, and we will meet again
21st
during the half day in the afternoon to kind of finalize it. Present to you in October.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Excellent. We have an action item. We need to, we have to do this every year. There's a, normally for expenses, you know, there's a list of here's what they want to play, and we approve them. We say, okay, you understand, here's the cost for that field trip, here's the cost for that sort of thing. But we always have a standing order so that we don't have to come in and approve payroll, so either we're holding up teachers' paychecks or someone's having to come here every 2 weeks. It's a regular recurring amount, it's contractually controlled. So what we do every year is we pass a motion saying that we approve a standing order for the business office to release any and all payroll obligations and related withholding, yada, 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 for the, as approved by the superintendent, his or her designee. And I guarantee you, Bruce will approve it just by glancing at it because the designee just left. She cuts those things automatically. They get a deposit of people's stuff.
Thank you.
So I would entertain a motion that we approve the standing order to release all contractual and other payroll obligations related to holding for the year 2018-2019.
So moved.
Second. Second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And with the Ethan's here, they printed this with only 5 lines. So if we want to sign and date that and then give that back to Bruce. So one of the things that concerning parties and I asked about communication, or talk about communication is, where do we stand? I know we had talked about this last year. Do we have an official Facebook page for the districts or somewhere, a place where rather than a rumor being started on the Stockbridge Connections Facebook group that kind of came about really when people were trying to figure out who had an ATV that could go get them something from Bethel after Irene.
Right.
It would be great if we had, and I don't know if the SU supports that, but if there was some official place where, a parent could ask that sort of question and someone might, administration or someone might be able to respond. I know we don't want to, I think it's important to have the official school page where we say, here's the picture of the kiddos snorkeling and that sort of thing, not be something that the community gets to bring up obnoxious issues on or whatever, but I think it's important that we do have some sort of way that rather than someone having to pay attention to you know, Front Porch Forum and two or three different Facebook groups and whatever goes on in Rochester, and listen to who's saying what in the Max parking lot, or who's saying what over down at Stony Brook Tavern.
There is an RSVP, I forget the exact name of it, Facebook page, but I think that people still go to the other pages
to
go and complain.
So if we just,
I've been trying to post agendas just on that page and not on Stockbridge Connection so that they associate with that.
Think about something to say and put it there, and then tell the other places, start looking here, because if we can start herding all our community cats to that one place where they could see those sorts of things, and because what sometimes seems to happen is, you know, you see something on Front Page Forum, but then it gets kind of misquoted on one of the Facebook pages, and then a third person calls me up and says, you know, it's kind of like the evil version of telephone. So if we could think about ways that we can do that, and I don't want to have the board start co-opting the official reporting out of the cool stuff that's happening in school. I think those need to be separate. But I think if we can think of a way to do that and maybe have, you know, I mean, do you guys on the official school Facebook page, do you post like the weekly newsletter or whatever goes on in the weekly folders or stuff?
We're actually updating the Facebook. Rochester had a Facebook page. I'm not sure if Stockbridge did. They have one. And we did talk briefly in pre-week with Casey and Lisa about how we would go forward with the Facebook page. Mm-hmm. Because one of the things we have to be very careful of is if we're going to use it as a forum to get questions answered, then somebody's got to be regularly checking.
Right.
The issue is you have to be very careful about who's regularly checking it because of the answers they give.
Correct.
So part of me thinks we need to think pretty carefully about this.
Right, and that's where
I think. Can't maintain
more
that information gets out that you.
Oh, it's always worse. You know, if a restaurant or a diner doesn't have, you know, a web page, it's much better than a diner that has a web page that's showing specials from March 2015.
Right, 2015.
So I think I agree with that. I think it's important that we figure out, you know, how we handle. Like I said, I think we do a good job of communicating the stuff that's going on at school, mm-hmm. per se. But I think having a way that we can, you know, handle some of that communications, and I don't know how other schools do it. Like I said, I don't want to overcommit you guys to doing that, because I think your job, first of all, is, you know, to administer the schools and educate our kids, and less about worrying about, you know, who's crappy in the neighborhood.
Well, what type of stuff are you anticipating?
Well, just general, like the some of the discussions around, you know, like the issue with the school lunches. And people starting to complain about it in one place. So by the time someone noticed it, it had already kind of a couple of people had worked themselves up into a frenzy. You know, if there was a place that we could be, you know, looking for some of those things or having some of that. And I don't know maybe other schools don't even differentiate between communicating to the community and talking about the school. But I think.
Yeah, let us make a couple calls.
Sure, absolutely. This is not something I expect we're going to solve tonight, or we're going to wordsmith our profile picture or take a profile picture right now. But I think it's important that when I think about some of the things that you know, the last administration here let kind of get away from them. And again, a lot of that stuff couldn't be talked about because it involved, you know, student issues and FERPA and confidentiality. But again, just to put when I looked at that or heard about that, just the idea if we could somehow have like a channel for community communications.
The other thing to think about, and I could call a couple people and get a cost on this, is that I think a number of you know that I'm on a school board over the other side of the mountain, and we use this program called Let's Talk, and it's been tremendously helpful. Because if people really want answers to questions, that's where they go to. They don't go on Facebook where you can kind of sometimes keep the pot boiling. And as the board chair over there, I probably get 10, 12, 15 contacts a month from people who want to know things about what's going on in Otter Valley. I heard this happen. What's this? What's that? Certain ones go to the superintendent. Certain ones go to the board chair. But there's more of a, how do I want to say this? It's not totally public. If people really want to get information on something and they're really interested in solving the problem versus versus keeping the pot boiling, they go to this Let's Talk application.
Yeah, that'd be good to know. I've never heard of that.
And I have no idea what it costs or, but I can find that out.
If you could, yeah, if you could just get us an idea or just, you know, think about what, you know, other schools about our size do.
Right. And then what we do is every month at the board meeting, I give a brief report out of I had 7 contacts and they were on these 7 topics. And the superintendent reports out she had 5 contacts on these 3 topics.
And that would be great because that could be then, you know, it's part of the minutes and then it's up on the website and then you read, people are able to see, here's the stuff people are asking and we can point some of the people that might start stirring a pot to say, you know, if you reach out in this forum, you'll get an official answer and, you know, point them at the kind of questions that people were answering, asking and seeing those answers. Because again, you know, I think it's important that we have, you know, we're regarded as competent and communicative and, you know, we've the more public trust we can have, I think the more number one space we'll get when, you know, when something goes wrong, there won't be this immediate, oh, they're already at school, I'm getting started, they're already screwing up.
Right.
You know, versus there's a problem, here's the channel, I go here, I got an answer, then I can tell my neighbor, oh yeah, I asked about that last week, or I asked about that yesterday, and they said, blah, 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 Lindsay's bringing lunch, they're bringing sandwiches down, they got a person who's being held up because there's a state backlog for fingerprints.
And I think the other thing to always remember is we probably had 10 people reach out to us very positively. Can I drive down? Can I help Julie make them? Does Stockbridge need anything? And I know that the Stockbridge folks had the same volunteers coming through the door. So it's always keeping in perspective the pot boiling.
And the squeaky wheels.
Who truly are interested in helping out.
Exactly. I just think it's important that
I agree.
We're showing that we're communicative. And I think in the long run, less about this, you know, it's less about like refighting this battle for this, the food service person quitting in August, and more about, you know, if we can direct people to a channel where they can go and get a positive answer and feel like, oh, I can get, you know, I can send a question here or I can do this, and I get something I can trust to take to the bank, I think is
important.
Going a long way.
I do farmer's market in Rochester every Friday, and it's pretty much about flowers, and I get a lot of people that come in and ask me about school issues. So I actually like have been writing down the list of concerns, just I was probably going to email you both tomorrow with them. And I think if we had, I always say, you know, if you really want to talk, you should really, you know, go to the principals. They have every question they've ever asked, and like they've given me excellent answers. But I do think some people don't make that step. So, and they will just come to a board member town or, you know,
which is fine. Too.
But I think it would be good to have that ways of communication.
Right, and then, but as a board member, if you could say, if you could redirect them to the,
that's what I've been
the question thing. But I mean, but it's easier to write a question online than it is to walk to Bonnie's office or call up on the phone.
Exactly.
You know, you can say, oh, we have an online question and answer forum. Go to blah, 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 blah. There's a link on our website. I mean,
the other thing, Maggie, is they sometimes won't take the step and pick up the phone, but as board members, if you can ask, is it okay if we ask Lindy or Bonnie to call you? Can we is it okay if I say you have this concern and ask one of them to give you a call? Because that's sometimes easier than making the call going the other way.
I think
that's a really good idea. And probably if you do that, ask if there's a good time to call too.
I will.
So that was that. I'm not sure if these are artifacts from the last time building the Rochester facility and merger, or if there's new information to speak to on 8.2, 8.3, 8.4.
I can speak to 8.3 quickly. I have a number of appointments the next couple weeks with different contractors, Efficiency Vermont, plumbers, septic folks, to talk about, you know, buttoning up that high school building for winter. Probably have much more to report, if not at the October, then the November meeting. Also, I'm in contact with communications, a phone company, trying to balance out the number of lines we have going into the Rochester campus. The little bit to tease out there is up to a certain number of lines, you get free long distance, and then when you drop below those lines, you pay for long distance. So
you got
to
balance.
The most sense. They're
kind of coming and going.
They do. So just a number of meetings. One thing
to EC fiber for the telephone.
Consolidated Communications too, that's the other group.
That is who we, that's who the standalone, but I do know EC Fiber does telephone too.
Okay.
Besides just internet. I don't know the cost of it, but.
Right.
Let me get the fourth question.
The other thing I'd like to do, and I'm just asking, just letting the board know that we're going to move forward to this. I'm going to meet with Mark Blunt, Libby and I, to ask him. He mentioned that it's either Chelsea or Tunbridge, I don't know which one, actually did hire a civil engineer to come right into their buildings, go right through the systems top to bottom, and he said the report they got back was extremely informative. And,
yeah, that'd be great.
You know, after I talk with him, we'll have a better sense of if we're going to recommend that for our two buildings. But it certainly makes sense to start with a report that's got some expertise for it.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, yeah.
What Lindy and I know about plumbing and heating systems.
Right, and that would be a lot better than I mean, you could I could trust you to talk to a contractor and he would tell you things and you'd write that and say, the contractor said this,
yeah.
The plumber said that, the heating guy said this,
yeah.
But I think so, a civil person. Now, do you have any idea what they paid for that?
That's what I want to talk to Mark about, what it
because,
costs.
Because, I mean, I would hate to hold that up. I'd like to get that started. So, I mean, if it's, do you have any clue, Bruce?
I don't know.
$1,000?
I don't know. $1,000 either. So,
yeah,
that's, that seemed to be.
I think we're okay. I think for
might have been before I was a dealer. I don't know.
I mean, I think for this winter, it's very clear. We're going to button it up. We're going to get it
right.
as efficient as we can.
Right. We don't have a lot of time to do major construction.
Exactly.
Or
but I think to gather some information around what kind of information they got, what did it cost, I know it was helpful.
Okay. Well, then if you could, it would be great if you could come back to us with a proposal, a quoted proposal. I don't think we need to get three at this point because it'll be under $15,000, I don't know. But, you know, it's going to be. Yeah, oh no, it should be out of maybe when it's 15 or higher.
I was going to say, I don't even think it'll be close to that.
No, but I mean, I think in the bylaws or the policy of 15,000 or law, it's $15,000, you got to get three. But I think if it's less than three and this guy's worked for Tunbridge and Chelsea. Tunbridge and Chelsea and is reputable.
And John
Jones.
Not
really.
If
you want a traffic light.
If
you want a traffic
light. I would love us to get a quote that you guys thought was valid and could stand behind that we could bless in October so that we could have some information to be talking to because I guarantee that would be a large part of our annual meeting and budget discussions. And especially, you know, even if we're, I mean, I'm not sure we'd get anything in time for it to have to really inform next year's budget, but it would be great. We get something that we could be able to tie saying, here's some steps we're taking going forward for the 1920 year. That would really be good. Our communities want to see us moving towards a resolution of facilities, whatever they are.
Yeah.
And so positive steps and you know, would be good. And I also think that, you know, we held off really forming a building committee last time, I think because I think before we actually have a committee, especially that includes community members, that we need to have something that they can be working from.
Yep.
Rather than saying, just, okay, walk into our buildings, look around, what do you think should happen here?
Right.
You know, a sort of group of parents, teachers, and board members being able to say, here's a professional document that lays out these sorts of steps. How do we want to fit our program into those steps is where we're actually going to get good work done. We're not going to get it, I think, by just throwing a bunch of people in these buildings and saying, hey, Joe Public, let's sort this out.
Right, we can just, if somebody's expressed interest, take their name.
And tell them that we're getting some professional opinions and advice put together, and then we're going to go from there.
Yep. So
yeah, I have a couple names and we do have a building committee. I know one that's interested in another. I haven't contacted her, but I think that she would be
Yeah, absolutely. I was going to say stream them along. Don't stream them along. Let them know what our timeline is, and you haven't forgotten them, and then you know keep their you know let them know that we would appreciate their service when the time is right. Because
absolutely.
I know that you have a lot of background in that between you and your husband.
Well, he's one of them, and then Cricket and Custer and Rochester.
Okay, well, that's those are two good names.
Those are two.
And I don't think there was anything about the merger we were really going to talk about. Like I said, I think that's a agenda.
I think just regarding.
actually doing. I think that would help with people understanding, like,
maybe like a monthly, yeah. Maybe like a monthly paragraph.
Well, that's one thing. We've got to get Lisa out from under the Lisa and Casey, but we're out from under the wave of starting at school and right. Tracking all those people. But we talked about two things. We'd like to model what Stockbridge has done with newsletters, because Rochester has not been as forward with those as Stockbridge has. And then actually putting on, you know, coming up with a joint Facebook page that just has, as Carl said a few minutes ago, pictures of kids struggling, you know, fifth, sixth grade, thank you, Boston Science Museum, just sort of information blasts.
Right.
Just things
spaghetti
like
dinner in Rochester this night. Pizza. Absolutely. You are absolutely right. Okay, so we actually have one more thing to do, and it relates to the food service program. Bruce points out that when Jordan resigned, it was actually July 27th, it wasn't beginning of August, it was end of July, but when he resigned, we never formally accepted his resignation letter. So I would entertain a motion to accept the resignation of Jordan Swank as the food service manager at the Stockbridge campus.
No. I don't accept it.
refrigerators in every classroom in Rochester. So there's public member, more than one, that's come up to me and heard about it and is one key answer where, why we have to approve it in our budget, where the money's coming from. But that's something I'd like to be able to answer.
Sure, the money comes from the equipment line item. What we did make was, we had, I'm struggling a little bit with my words here. Last year's morning arrival, the whole situation was just completely unacceptable. Youngsters were crying, youngsters were sometimes getting hurt. It just wasn't working out. There were too many kids in a gym. They were supervised, but it's hard to supervise that many youngsters in a gym. We checked around for other models. But let me back up one more thing. Teachers were also continually saying that they didn't have adequate time for literacy instruction or mathematics. Literacy instruction, best practice calls for between 90 and 120 minutes. We had some teachers that were down around 60. Mathematics was the same thing. Best practice calls for 75 to 90. We had some teachers that were down around 45 or 50. So what we've done is gain a full 15 to 20 minutes of instructional time by going to the breakfast in the classroom model. So youngsters come in, come off the buses, go directly to their classrooms, get their breakfast. Julie's already stocked the refrigerators. And by some classrooms, by 5 of 8, they're doing morning meeting, they're doing read aloud, some of them are actually doing journaling. As teachers describe it, they're not spending the first 20 minutes of the day trying to sort out all that went wrong before school even started. So that is the rationale. If I've overstepped, you just need to let me know. My understanding has always been that as long as the administrator works within the confines of the budget, that there can be some discretion exercised between line items. So I didn't ask for the board's permission to purchase refrigerators. Maybe I should have, but I didn't.
I guess I have. It's come up a couple of times, and I think the explanation when I asked you, I asked my child what she thought of the change in the breakfast. Like, do you like having breakfast in the cafeteria, or do you like it in the classroom? And she definitely really enjoys the classroom setting much more. It's much more peaceful. I know there's not the chaos that, you know, you could. It looked like fun, but it was like a little too much
consciousness.
A little too much fun too early in the morning before you start school. I just wanted to make sure that if we're doing changes, that, you know, we're assessing how the teachers are managing those changes, and how, if we have a good explanation to the public of why these changes happen. And I think you always have a really great answer, and it always comes down to what's best for kids. I think that will satisfy those. But I definitely think that's a question that's out there, and I think that
I would always encourage board members to send folks, my way to because I'd invite a couple parents in and they could walk through with me and see how it's working and what's happening. And I think on the opposite side, there's always parents who are pleased with something, so they don't think about going to a board member. But, you know, the number of parents that have stopped me in the hallway and said, this is just a remarkable difference in the start to the school day.
Absolutely.
So, you know, I think, but I do want to talk with folks who are wondering.
And these are people that might not have children in school. They're just community members that, you know,
sure,
they're hearing things and budgets.
Right.
And
yeah,
it's heading that off, and just having an answer.
Exactly.
Having a line of communication,
exactly,
that a real answer can be provided.
And encourage them to ask the questions. I think it's important. I think it's great that they're coming to you and they're saying these things, and then you're passing them on. We're starting to build a feedback loop.
I'm trying to keep a list of the questions I've
asked
in the public.
But
I really like this suggestion, Bonnie. I think it's the best. Do you want me to have it for you?
I really like
that. I think that's great.
I'm going to get
it. Because oftentimes parents won't do it. They just won't pick up the phone.
Correct.
And this way you get a response and you get it directly from you.
Looking at that software, the same kind of software thing.
Ways that we can do that.
You can have them call me, which they won't do.
Honestly, the lack of administration that we had in good leaders we've been lacking last year. Having that, if you're willing for me to give your phone number out, I think that will build a lot more trust in terms of who's, you know, sailing these ships right now.
Some of us love change. We jump up and say, hooray, change is coming. Most of us, with a little information a little time. We adapt to change. And then some of us, you know, you have to drag us kicking and screaming through the door because we just so dislike change.
I think, you know, virtually anything we do in school kind of falls along those lines. I think the caution for us who work in schools is to never discount any one of those groups of people.
Okay.
You need to spend a lot of time with people who just don't feel comfortable with change. You need to spend time with folks who probably could support it, but they just need to understand it better. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you just need to slow down the folks who, yay, we're going to change something, let's get going. So, you know, I know I speak to Lindy and both of us is that, you know, we want to talk with parents. If anybody has any concern, you know, you need to send them our way or ask, is it okay if I give her your number?
That would be wonderful.
And you can also put up that, again, part of the reason these things happen so quickly is that we're continuously trying to improve.
Oh,
you know, this cycle of continuous improvement is really important. You know, it's, we see something, we think we can make it better, let's just do that, and then let's assess and evaluate, you know, the results of what we did, like, versus the bureaucratic, there's an idea, perhaps we should have a meeting about that, perhaps we should talk about that, and then we'll